everybody, it's Mike Jeff for Chicago Jazz Magazine, chicagojazz.com. It is 11:30 today, Friday, and welcome to Chicago Music Revealed, Episode 5. Episode 5, can you believe it? And let me see if I can turn this up a little. Let me give me a little. There we go. There we go. Okay, well, welcome to Friday. How are we all doing? I switched the time to 11:30 today, trying to catch more people because I think that having lunch and watching Chicago Music Reveal might offer a better option than at 10:30 in the morning. Although, I don't know, I like 10:30 because I get up early, so who cares, right? So anyways, before we get into the whole thing, what a beautiful day today. It is out there in the beautiful Chicago area. I got out, did a run this morning. Gorgeous. Lots of sun, lots of cheer, lots of people with masks on. It's the new norm here in Chicago, so hopefully everybody's staying safe, washing your hands. I wanted to also let everyone know that on chicagojazz.com, as I do this every single day so far this week, this is episode 5 of Chicago Music Revealed, on chicagojazz.com, we have an entire list, and it's growing, of relief funds and GoFundMe pages for Chicago musicians and also staff of venues that are, you know, that need help, because not just because the musicians are not working because the venues are all closed, which is devastating to the entire industry. And that, you know, we can talk about the event industry and everywhere else, but also it's devastating to the fact that the staffs of all these venues, whether it's an event venue, whether it's a club, a restaurant, they're all furloughed, man. Nobody's making any money at all. And so there's GoFundMe pages, some of our favorite clubs here at Chicago Jazz Magazine, of course, the Jazz Showcase, Jazz Showcase, Green Mill, Winters is furloughed. I don't know if they have a GoFundMe, but I know everybody over there isn't working right now. So I know that there's some funds out there available. There's also the Metro, there's Martyrs, there's Kingston Mines actually came up with a GoFundMe a couple of days ago. So check out chicagojazz.com. If you can spare a couple of bucks, that'd be great. Also, big news. 2 days ago, D-Case sent out an email to everybody. I get it because I'm connected with D-Case because of the Year Chicago Music and because I present all these festivals downtown. It's a proud sponsor, I should say. They have a special artist. What is it? I don't know the full name, but it's through the Arts Council. And there's funding for individual musicians, $1,500 grants, and then also nonprofit organizations, $3,000 to $6,000. You have to fill out forms and put in, and they will do it on a, you know, obviously they're going to vet everything and see who deserves it, and there's a limited amount of funds. So jump on, if you go to the cityofchicago.org, that's usually where all the good information is on everything that's popping. And of course, then you have all the government assistance, the stimulus package. I mean, there's a small business loan, there's different grants. They've also approved funding and extension of funding for independent musicians, 1099 employees, private contractors, the gig economy. They're extending and expanding the unemployment benefits. So it really actually makes a lot of sense for you as a musician or an artist to actually file not for unemployment, because you might get something a little bit more than you normally would by doing that in normal times. So, okay, moving on. Last night, now I usually talk about all the events that are performed on Facebook Live because they've been great, and I think I'm going to have a special contributor start doing that next week. So we're going to see. We've been in some discussions with somebody that wants to take the reins, wants to jump on every day and tell us what's happening on the Facebook Live scene. And since we're moving this show to 11:30, that might be better because this person gets up a little later than me. So we'll see what happens. But either way, Monday I'm going to have a list. So if you have events coming up in Chicago or anywhere, actually, anybody watching this on Facebook, if you have something coming up, you guys are doing like a live stream from a living room, from a live television, you get the sneezes and everything included. If you have an event coming up on Facebook Live you want to promote next week, hit me up, leave it in the comments. We'll be sure to mention it. Last night, my wife and I were able to stream Facebook Live events on our television. So we were watching, first we saw Liz Mandeville doing great. She was by herself doing a solo set, doing a blues happy hour. Pretty cool. Very cool stuff. And then also at 7 o'clock, and this had to be one of the most interesting things I've seen. And I knew it was going to be interesting, but we got an extra bonus. Miles Hayes and Amanda Wolf, they're married and they have a son, Aiden, and they did a live from the living room set. And halfway through it, Aiden decided to join in a couple of times, and it was classic live performance stuff that you would not see at the Green Mill. So actually, hopefully they keep doing this because it was very entertaining. Miles was playing, a gourd at one point, and Amanda was playing drums on the back of a guitar, and then there was a ukulele, and then Aiden got involved with a ukulele that was broken, and he wanted a sucker. It was great. It was fantastic stuff. So it was good stuff. They had good views too. So my wife and I watched it for an hour. We were like, this is awesome. Hopefully they do this regularly, 'cause it was very entertaining. So congratulations, guys. That was fun. So if you have any events coming up or anything coming up, hit us up. Leave me a comment. I can see all your comments here. I can see we got some viewers, and I'm sure the viewers are probably clamoring because I am going to bring on a good friend of mine, Nick Schneider. I thought I would check in with him. He's out in the western suburbs and part of the Trio One, the famous Trio One of Chicago, who plays all the Christmas gigs in the corporate area and beyond. And Nick and I have been playing together forever. So, Nick, are you there?
Hello.
Hey, Mike. There you are.
Can you hear me? Let me take my mask off. Is that better?
No, that sounds much clearer. Yeah, you sound way better. Way better. So how is it on the Western front out there? Is everybody everybody's doing okay, you and Jean, your wife?
It looks okay, yeah. Well, we got a big enough hospital. I saw her yesterday downstairs. Then I just stay away from her.
Well, that's why you've been married so long, right?
Yeah, 53 years, that's all, away from me. You don't have to be 6 feet, could be 10 feet, 12 feet, could be another floor.
Half a mile. So you're probably, you're somebody that's always playing, six, seven gigs a week, so you're probably still booked, right? You're probably booked up, you got all these things happening. The coronavirus doesn't scare off Nick Schneider in his bass, right?
No, matter of fact, here's what I did since I don't have anything. There was a warm day last week, so I went out and I took my bass out on my deck, outside. Okay, so I'm out there. I figured, I just put a couple of scales and warm up a little bit. There's no one out here, actually, nobody out doing yard work, except somebody from Spring Green, I guess, with the with that fertilizer.
Oh yeah.
A guy comes down with a mask and he's in my next door neighbor's yard spraying, and he looks at me with the bass on the deck and he says, "Hey, you better get in, man. That thing's gonna cause a virus." I said, "Do you ever see one of these before?" He goes, "No." I said, "Okay, goodbye."
He said, "Yeah, I usually talk over it when people play it."
Yeah, talk over the bass solo, man. That's it. Yeah.
Well, I can remember. So, so Nick and I were part of the famous Trio One trio, and usually Demos Petropoulos joins us in the Trio One, and every once in a while, Tom Uhlner's with us and Jim Sellers. But, we play all these different corporate events. We used to do a lot of clubs, and we've also traveled and done a lot of crazy things up in Wisconsin at some of those Holiday Acre gigs. And Kohler, remember that Kohler, Wisconsin gig? We were playing, you and Tommy Weitzis and I were playing next to about 100 toilets in the showroom at Kohler.
You booked some good stuff, man. You booked some good stuff, Mike. Yeah, it was good. Yeah.
But how does it feel now? I mean, because you're somebody who's used to performing constantly, and now you're like sitting at home. I mean, because you have your regular jam session when times are normal on Wednesdays, at Manhattan's out in, where is that, West Chicago?
It's in Carroll Stream.
Carroll Stream.
Yeah.
But what's it feel like now? I mean, you're just sitting at home.
Nothing. You know, it's like a drag, real drag, man. So I just wonder if I can learn how to play again, Let's see, a tune of bass, G, D, A, C sharp. No, I can't remember. Well, who cares? Just play it anyway, But it's been a real drag. I'm sure not only for me, but for everyone, involved. I just got off the phone with talking to different people. They call each other now. Musicians always like to call and gossip, so.
Right. I know. Well, they don't call me, But then when I want to get gossip, I'll just call you, and you've already talked to 10 people about it, and I'll get the lowdown, and then I'll know what's going on, you know.
That's how it goes. It goes, you know, bad news travels real fast around Chicago.
Yeah, good news never gets anywhere. No. Good news is no fun.
No. No, man.
So you were actually one of the last inner, well, not the last, but you're actually going to live on in infamy, because I used to do the show. I had that video show. I did 149 episodes of Talking Jazz over at Johnny O's Hot Dogs.
Yeah,
and,
remember
and
that?
I had you and Eric Schneider and Tom Uhlner came down. You guys did a whole skit. Tommy was cooking. Yeah. You were working behind the counter, and Eric just showed up to eat free Polish sausages.
Yeah, yeah.
And
yeah, that was a good show, man. It was like, I think your 100th show. And I encourage people to go back and look at that, because I think that was one of our better presentations.
Oh, I agree.
Yeah.
And now it's closed.
Yeah, now Johnny O's is closed, huh?
Yeah, there's some rumor that they think you guys put them out of business, but
I didn't bring anything in there. Oh man.
So you do a lot of teaching too. So when you're teaching and stuff, now you can't even teach, right? Because you don't do online lessons. So you're probably talking to some students on the phone, right? But you can't do any teaching.
Yeah, I try to do FaceTime thing.
Mm, yeah.
You know, the other day, and you know, I was looking at the kid's hand. I said, "Is that your hand or your right hand? I can't see." He's moving his phone around, and I was moving my phone around. So that was a drag, you know. So I said, he says, "Are you going to charge me?" And I go, "No, forget it. See you later."
I'll see you in person sometime.
Yeah, well, you know, unless you got a setup. And, you know, I'm not into all of that, you know, like, you know, you're like in forefront of with this thing that you're doing now, man. This is great.
I'm figuring it out, as I always preface stuff. You know, I'm prefacing it the fact that I don't know what I'm doing. So I'm running the whole board. So when I have a technical mishap and a big crash or whatever the heck happens, you know, it's my fault, and who cares? It's my show.
Yeah.
So what?
Yeah. Yeah. So what? But, at least you're trying, Mike, and a lot of people aren't, you know,
that's true.
But,
that's true. That's the only
you always were in the vanguard of new technology and things, not only with the Chicago Jazz Magazine, but with all the other stuff too, you know, the ways of booking things. And I've seen you handle some nice accounts that we shared, and you did a better job than me. So, you know, it's time for me to just go get the gig and turn it on to you.
That's right. I don't have, could you start scouring the area? Cause I'm a little light on gigs right now. Could you get moving on that, please?
Yeah. Well, I got something coming up. Let's see. What is it? It's in March of 2021.
Let me see if I'm open. I'll let you know after the show.
Yeah, right. Yeah, we'll have to look it over, man. But now I'll tell you, man, you know what, it's like, you know, you think about what's his name, Bruce Oscar, the guy I work
right,
with.
Yeah, right. WDCB.
WDCB. And you know, he, well, by the way, I think he'll be on radio starting Monday, because they sequestered him because he had spent some time in a hospital, and they didn't want to, you know, whatever. The studios are pretty small, and you know, virus and all of that, so they spray it down
right
before he gets there. But you know, his jazz calendar and your jazz calendar on your on the magazine was always, you know, something to look forward to, you know, and now there's nothing, you know.
Yeah.
It's really something, I tell you. Well, you know, this is something that you'll be able to tell your grandkids, if you have any, or whatever.
People I run into that are younger.
2020 was a real, real bumper crop year, man. Started off great, man. And then all of a sudden, bam, what, about 3 weeks ago?
Yeah,
everything
was
shut
normal.
Down
yeah, everything was normal until like 3 weeks ago.
Yeah, yeah.
You
three weeks ago.
It's pretty stunning. I mean, you know, and it's not because of the coronavirus, but we should mention it. You know, we lost it. Well, because of the coronavirus, we lost Ellis Marsalis. We've lost Wallace Roney. Just this week, we've lost Bucky Pizzarelli, who I know you've played with Bucky, I think, haven't you?
Yeah, sure.
In the past. And then also not due to the coronavirus, but I wanted to have you on, too, to talk a little bit about the legend Bobby Ojeda, who passed away last week. You know, it wasn't because of the coronavirus. He wasn't in good health for a while, but you used to play with him. You used to judge things. You did a lot of stuff with Bobby.
We did a lot of stuff together, and you know what, a great arranger. And you know, he did arrangements for me. Like I sometimes would book something that I would need a quick arrangement with. And, first of all, I would just call him and put him on the gig.
Yeah.
And then, you know, to make sure I got him. And then I'd say, by the way, I'd call him back, you know, an hour later. And he'd go, what do you got now? And I said, well, listen, there's two singers and two dancers, and we need to do a routine on a thing, and I need an arrangement real quick on this thing like that. He said, well, when you need it? I said, well, how about the day after tomorrow? That's when the rehearsal was. And you know what? He was a sweetheart. He would come through with that, and it would be just a top flight arrangement, that everybody could read. Nothing real difficult to read, but and make the singers and dancers shine. So what a great guy. And then all the gigs that we used to work with him and Bobby
Santana, right? Oh yeah.
Yeah, that band was on for many, many years. I'm going to say 40 years or better.
Mm-hmm.
That I played with those guys. And, Bill Porter and Bobby Ojeda and Bobby Santana, as well as just a cast of thousands, of great players, And we always had a lot of fun on those gigs, whether it be in a basement of a church or a concert, it didn't make any difference. We always sounded great, man, we had a lot of fun over the years,
Well, he played he played with Basie, right, for mm-hmm. a while, right? I mean, did he do any arrangements with Basie?
Yeah, he did. As a matter of fact, I was up in Shell Lake when I used to do my jazz, a teaching thing, clinic. And lo and behold, I'm looking through the library one day and I said, hey, here's a Bobby Ojeda chart that he wrote for the Tonight Show Band, which I had played.
Mm-hmm.
When the Tonight Show Band would come in town, I would play a little bit with them, when I passed through. And it was A Night in Tunisia, and easy to read, swung, open for solos. It was great, man,
Yeah, right?
Yeah, it was really nice, man. So, great arranger and super guy, man, And we did the Luminarts thing quite a bit for many years.
That's right.
And then the last time that we were there, he was supposed to be one of the judges, and I asked around, where is Bobby? He said, well, Bobby just checked into the hospital. So then he was in and out, and then, of course, he went back in and then passed away at Elmer's Hospital last week. So
This was, and that was just in February, right? End of February? Is that when it was? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the Luminarts, he used to be really connected with Jim Gillespie over there.
Right.
Luminarts, just a little background for people. It's an art society that was put together by Jim Gillespie, basically. I think he founded the thing over at the Union League Club. And what they do is they give scholarships to musicians between, I think there's different age groups, but it goes from 18 to 30, I think now is that age group. So some of the professionals that get out of college and they need to do a recording, they need to do something, there's a competition, they have judges, and then they have their big finale competition, which is at Buddy Guy's, which you and Bobby... And every once in a while, I think Tom Muehlner used to be there every once in a while. And different guys would.
Hope was the piano player last time.
That's right. And you guys would judge. And then the musicians, they would award like 5 or 6 scholarships of like $5,000.
Well, $7,000.
Yeah.
They give away probably $30,000-$40,000 on that day, Mm-hmm. I didn't get that, but
you got a $100 ticket for parking in a tow zone. I told you to beat it.
But we did, I'm gonna say gee, I'm going to say that we've done that thing for 15, 16 years, maybe longer, you know.
Well, you had to have done it for at least, well, I mean, because I started the magazine, and I can remember covering it like in 2005, maybe, something like that.
Yeah.
And you guys were doing it, and you'd already done it for a couple of years.
Sure, yeah.
You know, so, I mean, that's interesting. But, yeah, he's going to be really greatly missed on the scene once the scene gets going, because he used to play with a lot of different people. I know Petra Van Nuys, Van Nuys used to have him on a lot of her gigs. And then, of course, he used to always play with some of the big bands around town. You'd always see him popping in on different things, and he would show up in different recordings. And then, of course, the arrangement stuff that he used to do, you know, even in the background, he would do arrangements for recordings or for bands that
he did the last one was he did a nice big like 11 12 piece for Mark Pompey's CD, his last CD that he made, and I'm on it along with Bill Porter, Eric Schneider's on there. Mm-hmm. You know, everybody's on there.
Jimmy Ryan, wasn't Jimmy Ryan on there?
No,
who was it?
I know Rummage played drums. Bob Rummage played drums.
Yeah, he's okay.
Yeah. And
you would have sold a lot more if Mike Jeffers played drums, but you know, that's okay.
Yeah. Judy Roberts' husband was on there.
Oh, Fishman. Greg Fishman.
Battling
Eric.
Tenor and alto solos. The two of them are battling. See how many notes they could play in one, you know, on their chorus, you know.
On your recording. See how many notes they could play on your recording.
That's I got one little like solo on a tune. That was it. Eight bars or something. But no, it was well recorded, and it came out really nice, and Mark was real happy with it. Blah blah blah. So, and then of course Mark passed away.
Mm-hmm.
We did a big fun. We were going to do a fundraiser for him for medical expenses, but then we just changed one of the words and put it into a obituary type thing.
Right.
So when we had Petra,
yep,
and Judy Rabbit's sister, Holly, they put together this thing over in at Hackney's in Glenview.
Yep.
Must have had 275 people there, man. So
yeah, it was unbelievable. They were actually supposed to do it, and it was a snowstorm day, right?
So yeah.
What happened, and then did it get moved? Is that what happened?
Yeah, it moved to December 8th. Well, it was a nice day, so we didn't have to worry about that snow and stuff like that.
Well, Mark was somebody that – he was like the first guy that gave me a gig. So I remember when I came back to town from being at North Texas, and Paul Luca brought me out. That's the first time I met you, which was like 95, I think, 96. He brought me out to a lesson that he was having with you.
Yeah.
And so I came out with my
Oakland
drums.
College?
We came to your house down in the basement.
Okay.
We get there, and it's Paul's bass lesson with you, and you're looking at me, you're down in your office, you know, and I'm bringing my drum set in, and you're like, what is that? And you started retuning my drum set and telling me that I was playing wrong, taking everything apart. And I'm like, who is this guy, man? What's happening? I just went to North Texas. Why is this guy telling me that I need to fix things? But then I ended up hanging out. He's like, all right, Nick tells Paul, all right, you're done. You can go away. You're going to stay and play with the rest of my bass players today. So I stayed.
You had a squeak in your hi-hat pedal.
That's right.
And I told him, I said, you know, let's say that you're in a restaurant. You got a squeak in your hi-hat pedal. What are you going to do? Run out and buy some WD-40? No, go get some olive oil off the table.
And I have. How do you mute your bass drum in a restaurant? Just get a napkin over there.
Those are the little things that a lot of people don't know about, man. You know, what you have, you know.
Well, there's a lot. Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of that stuff, you know. I mean, so we started playing together with that, but then Mark Pompey hired me. I remember because then I went to, I was sitting at the Chambers and stuff, and Mark asked me if I wanted to do this gig with him at the casino boat down at the Showboat Casino down in East Chicago.
And
it was on Sundays from noon until 5 p.m.
And
it was him and Witz, Bill Klewitz.
And a
trumpet. Sometimes Warren Keim was on it. Sometimes Ron DeWar was on it. I mean, there'd be different guys on there.
Yeah.
And the first time we're playing, we go down in the basement. I think you played it once in a while too, where we'd go down to the basement and get on the stage, and it would beep and would lift us out of the floor, and we'd start playing.
Yeah.
And it would spin around like this. And everybody would watch us while they were waiting in line to get on the casino boat. And then no matter what was happening in the middle of whatever, after 1 hour, it would beep and suck you back down into the floor.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, Daniel, you're on a break now. Yeah.
And I remember Ron DeWar, man, he was playing like one of the most incredible solos. He's playing over some Charlie Parker tune. And we're burning, man. And it starts beeping. And I heard it, so I'm watching. His eyes are shut, man, and he's blowing. And we get down into the basement. And Mark didn't have the heart to tell him we were in the ground at that point.
No one played
for another 5 minutes, and Ron opens up his eyes, and we're in the basement, and there's like workers looking at him like, "What are you doing?
What are you doing, man? You're done for now, man.
Go take a break, dude. Go take a break." Yeah. But you used to play a lot of, man. We've played a ton of crazy gigs.
We
were up in we used to do that Holiday Acres gig up in Wisconsin, up in Rhinelander.
Rhinelander, yeah, we did that for years.
Go up, and we'd go up on a Thursday and hit golf balls, and then play the gig Friday and Saturday, but we played golf all day Friday, all day Saturday, you, Eric Schneider, and I. And then we would play the gig at night, and Eric would lie about his golf score over the microphone and say he shot better than he did. And then we would do it all again the next day. But we get some good stories.
Yeah, we did like the Mother's Day thing up there.
That's right.
And you know what? And we'd be driving up there, and, you know, we would, when we come in, we would drive past a golf course. And I think all of us would do the same thing. We'd turn in where the golf course was, you know, to see if there was, how much snow was on the ground.
Well, I remember that one time we played the gig. Chris White always played piano too. We played the gig. We played golf on a Friday in the afternoon. Then we played the gig for 4 hours. And it was a great gig. It was at a resort at Holiday Acres Resort on Lake Thompson, right in Rhinelander.
And they had a
hotel attached to it, plus cabins. So we all got like cabins. I think you had a hotel room. They put us up, man. It was great. They were really into it. You used to actually play there back in the day, too.
Yeah, I started playing there with Dave Remington.
You did a gig with Buddy Rich up there, though, too.
The first time I played, I was on the road with Buddy back in 68, and he said, "We're going to go to the Holiday, you know, Holiday." We're thinking Holiday Acres. He said, "Well, we thought Holiday Inn."
Right.
You know, and we pull up to this place, you know.
in the middle of nowhere.
You know, I mean, that road that goes up to it is like 3 or 4 miles before you get to the resort.
Yep.
So I'm going, we're on a bus. I'm going, "Where the hell are we going, man?" You know. But once we got up there, they had that indoor pool.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember it was probably 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning. I decided to go swimming.
After the gig. A couple of the guys
in the band, you know. And the guy that owned it, man, was a real superb, all-out jazz fan. You know, and going back to the beatnik era with the sunglasses on and a dark black sweater. And a sport coat, you know.
He had that angular beard. I saw pictures of him on the wall.
Yeah.
I mean, he looked like a super beatnik dude.
Oh, yeah. And Jim, and I can't remember his last name anyway. He'd say, "What do you guys want to hear?" You know, I said, "Well, you got any Charlie Parker?" And bam, there it is. He had a record. He had a record player with a little sound system that went into this pool. So here it is, 3 o'clock in the morning. We're swimming around, playing Charlie Parker, man. You know, while this guy is, "You want something from the bar?" I said, "Yeah, well, why not?" So now we're drinking at 4 o'clock in the morning, and it started to get light. You know. I tell you what, man, you can't buy that stuff anymore, man.
No. And even when we were up there, I remember we were sitting at the bar after the gig, and it's snowing sideways. Now, we played golf in the afternoon, played the gig, and now it's snowing sideways. And Eric and I are sitting there with Chris White, and you come up, and you're like, all right, 10 minutes. Who wants to go to the casino?
Yeah, right. Yeah. So we drive through the snow, this blizzard, man, to go to the casino, which is a, which is 29 miles away, well, one
you,
way.
Well, let's preface this. You and Chris White drove to the casino. I looked at Eric. Eric's like, I'm not going to the casino. I go, I'm very comfortable here. You and Chris White went off into the in, into the great white north.
We go up there to see what would happen. And, you know, it was like something to do. Of course, now there's little casinos everywhere, you know.
Yeah. Well, I remember that the one time you came back from the casino, you didn't even go to bed, and we were supposed to go golfing. So at 9 in the morning, you're outside my cabin with two garbage can lids, like beating it like cymbals because won. So you were in a very good mood. So you were buying breakfast before we went golfing. Yeah. You're beating there like we're having a marching band. Now, one of those other gigs that we should talk about where a very famous photo is that I have here is that that gig that we played that I set up at the Capitol Grill in Rosemont. Yeah, it was for an event planner that I played. We played a couple of different gigs for this event planner, Barbie Wood. Awesome woman. And she would hire us. She had like one client throughout the entire country. So she would set these things up throughout the entire country. Well, they did a buyout at the Capitol Grill. And because it was for a kind of a corporate thing, and it was predominantly male corporate clients that were going to be there, you know, probably over 100 people, just cocktails and heavy appetizers and stuff. She hired a bunch of models. And so then Eric Schneider takes it upon himself on the first break, because, you know, he's floating around because you and I and Demos are actually playing. Eric would pop in and play a saxophone solo once in a while, and then he's floating around talking to everybody like he does. And so he sets up this photo shoot of this. And let me see if I can bring it up here. The famous photo. There it is. You can't see it, but there's a famous photo of you and Eric Schneider and Demos and myself. We're sitting there, and we've got the girls all around us posing. I think the one girl's got your bass, holding your bass.
She liked the bow. You know, she was on the bow.
Yeah. I mean, you know, this is like, and we did it on the spur of the moment, man. It was like 2 seconds, but I'm telling you, I've seen so many people love that photo. I love the photo. I think it should be on all our business cards, actually.
It's like, oh, yeah. Yeah. Yes. It's a killer, man. You know, and then somebody said, hey, what kind of a gig did you have last night, you know, or yesterday? Yeah. I said, well, here, take a look at this.
That's what happens when you're in Trio 1. You play a lot of these gigs.
In Trio 1, you get the best.
That's
man.
Right. Trio 2, Trio 3, I can't guarantee you're even
Yeah, you
get
can't
a parking
guarantee
spot,
anything man. Like that, you know.
That's right.
But those four models, they were there all day.
Mm-hmm.
And then when we shut down, we're going to our cars in the parking lot. Some of them were in the elevator, and I looked down. I said, what's the matter, honey? She goes, my feet are so swollen from wearing these stupid high heels. I said, well, take them off. Take your shoes off, you know.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah, you're off duty now.
Yeah, so, yeah. You know, but they had little slippers that they put on. But, man, you know, that was a long one, too, I think.
It was a four-hour gig, and there were so many people there that I think we played like an hour and a half, and then Barbie came up and said, guys, why don't you go get something to eat and something to drink?
Yeah.
And, you know, so we had drinks and steaks, and it was horrible. It's terrible. What a terrible gig it was.
Yeah, lobster. Yeah, really a drag, man. Yeah, man.
Well, you know,
we had some good ones. You booked some good ones, I tell you.
Oh, man. You know? Well, that one gig, and I don't have a picture of that, but of that gig that we did up in Kohler, Wisconsin. Where,
oh, that one, yeah.
For the weekend, and we played at the Kohler factory for like 80 high-end people. Stephanie Browning was on it, actually, with us, too.
Right,
because
they
wanted us to play, because we were doing the Peninsula Hotel every Friday and Saturday at that point. So they wanted that VIP group from the Peninsula up there. And then the next night we played at.
That's what all their water fountains and showers, you know, like, you know, how much would the shower be? Well, it'd be $25,000 for the shower, you know.
Right.
So, yeah, you would have, you know, lighting would change and mood music would come on in the shower, and it'd be, you know, maybe 15 or 20. Nozzles blowing at you, you know, whatever you want.
Yeah. and we're playing All the Things You Are.
Yeah, right. Right next to
it. Yeah. It was Tom Vitzis and you and I and Stephanie. Oh, it was great. But then the next night, we ended up going to the Kohler Estate, which is now, I want to say it's River Bend Country Club.
It is. Oh,
and
okay.
And we got to play on like the founder, with the great-grandfather Kohler, who invented all of this stuff. He has this grand piano in there from like the mid-1800s.
Yes.
Incredible. And I just remember playing there. And, you know, you're always sitting there. You're keeping an eye out while we're playing, as I am. But you notice more things. And he's like, look at that person's about to put their cocktail right on top of this piano from 1885. Man, look at that. Yeah. You know, I mean, it was crazy. But some of those things, it was gorgeous up there. We got to do that stuff. And then, of course, playing at the Peninsula every Friday and Saturday night for 4 years. We got to meet all the celebrities and all that stuff. So, I mean, it's been a... The Chicago jazz scene is quite a scene, you know, that people that don't play gigs and don't get out and see things, they would never know, you know?
Yeah, you never know. Yeah.
I mean,
the Peninsula was a good run, I would say, you know, for what's happening around, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Usually you get a run, and it might be 2 months or something like that, but that thing went out for, what, about 6-7 years, man.
I was on it for 4 years, Fridays and Saturdays, and then Thursdays in the summer. I mean, it was like, you know, Jazz Trio in the Lobby for 8:30 to midnight or something. I mean, it was great, and then we played all the corporate parties and all that stuff.
We did New Year's there, remember?
Oh, yeah. I can't remember that. Yeah. How could I forget that? Oh, my God.
That's what they wanted to have when it would be a time to play, you know, like in London, which was 5 or 6 hours ahead of us. The guy wanted to hear us play a Beatles tune, you know, because he was from London,
right?
The manager.
Yeah.
And I'm going, well, I don't know if I can keep these guys here for 5 or 6 hours to play a Beatles tune and then wait another 5 hours before we start. So, yeah.
I just remember because that was the first year that you bought all the charts, and you and Eric, your son Eric Remsner, got all the charts and got everything together. And I get there before the gig, and you guys are putting the books together. And I walked in, and you guys look like you've been up for like 4 days.
You look like
you got shot out of a cannon, man. And I was like, is this a good idea?
I still got that book.
Well, I borrowed that book the one time for a field museum gig, and that was the first and last time I would ever run a big band at a corporate gig. I was like, you know what?
Yeah.
I think I'll just farm this out to somebody else and get a commission for a finder's fee, because it is a lot of work to run
a corporate
jobbing band. And unless you're set up for that, I mean, like somebody like Dave Rothstein, perfect. He does a great job. He's got a system down and all that stuff. And there's a few other guys in town that do that. But man, to start
at the end of the New Year's Eve gig, it's like me and the guitar player who we had to stay over and play Sunday brunch.
Huh, yeah.
Luckily Eric, my son, got us a room, and here it is, 2 o'clock in the morning, and I'm tearing this stuff down. And then trying to get these books together and put them together on a cart and wheel them up to the little crow's nest that we had up there to store it. And then next day, bring it down to the car.
Mm-hmm.
And I asked my son, I said, can you get, you know, are you here to help me do all of this? He goes, no, we got a party to go to, man. So it was me and McIntyre, the guitar player, that had to do all of that, man, you know. Thanks, man.
He's the leader, man. He can't be bothered with this stuff. No, he can't be bothered.
He had the white jacket on, yeah.
Yeah, that's right. Oh, God. Hey, by the way, I should let you know before we jump off, you've got some fans on here. Liz Zenz is on here.
Okay.
And Steve Zenz. Hey, boys. Greetings from St. Paul.
Yeah.
Hey, Steve. Mm-hmm. And Tom, L-U-E-R, Lure.
Tom Lure from L.A.
Yo, yeah, Nick, listening from Los Angeles. Great to hear from you, your voice, my friend. We got Wayne Powers.
Oh, yeah, Wayne. Yeah,
Wayne's
sure.
Saying hi and has a Bobby Ojeda story. And then also John Scoville's on.
Oh, great.
See that? You're bringing in the crowd today, Nick. You're bringing in the audience, man.
Yeah, yeah.
We might have to have a regular segment on this show and do quick hits with the Trio One bassist in the Western suburbs. What's happening on the Western Front? during the coronavirus.
Yeah, right.
You can tell us if we need to be aware of anything in the city if it's coming our way.
Yeah.
The one thing I know that you're not missing is Chicago traffic.
You know what? I put gas in my car, 2 weeks ago? I filled it up. It's still on 3/4. Usually I would have to put gas in every other day coming down to work gigs with you.
I know, yeah.
And parking. What about the parking? Horrible parking things.
Hey, I always get to Trio One, always gets parking. So you don't have any problems with parking.
I'll tell you what. You always took care of us, Mike. And you know how much I appreciate that parking in downtown Chicago with all those elevators and things, man.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well,
except for that. Yeah, one where you keep going down in a hole by the river.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. The guy said, "Where are you?" He said, "Well, you're on 12 low, you know, lower level."
Yeah, right.
You're on 12 level, lower level. And we now gotta go up to 30 stories, you know. How are you gonna do that? Well, there's elevators.
Oh, that's the corporate gig that we play for Christmas. That's the corporate gig. I'm gonna actually have Jim Sellers on. I'm gonna have him on.
Oh, Jim Sellers, yeah.
Jim, the famous, the world legendary story of the missing cord at the keyboard cord gig.
His adapter. He went down to buy an adapter. I said, well, there's a Best Buy down by the.
Should we tell the story? So we get to this gig. We're setting up. There's like 300 people coming down. It's like at 2 o'clock in the afternoon in the middle of December, coldest day of the year. This was 2 years ago. He won't mind if we tell this story because it's great. So you and I are set
up. The wind chill factor was like 15 or 20 below.
Yeah.
You know, right by the lake, of course. Yeah.
And so, yeah. So we set up in the lobby of like 220 North Michigan Avenue, right? One of these gigantic corporate office buildings, and it's all glass windows, and there's a courtyard out there, and we can sort of see like Stetson over to the left. And so we set up, you know, we're talking, we get the power set up, and it's the three of us, and Jim's setting up the keyboard, and we're talking, we're all set up. We're like a half hour early, everything's cool. And right at 2 o'clock, there's going to be 300 people coming down, and they do like this holiday thing for 2 hours for the people for an hour on that side. And then we had to move to the other side of the building. So we're going to play for an hour and then take a 10-minute break and move all our stuff across the hallway to another spot. But
Sellers had this funny look on his face, and he was frantically going through his electric keyboard case, pulling out all kinds of things. And I said, "What's the matter, Jim?" And he said, "I left the adapter that connects, you know, the thing, so the piano won't work, you know." So I said, "Well, maybe you need another adapter." That's when he decided to go down to the Hancock building, Best Buy.
He goes to his car first in a frantic dash because he was using it the night before at Marie's Pizza or something.
Yeah.
So he doesn't have the power cord. So he can't plug his keyboard in. His amp's working, but the keyboard doesn't work. So he goes into the garage, like 14 levels down, like what you talked about, and he has no reception. He's calling it. It's hanging up on him. So then he comes up. Now we're 5 minutes to 2 o'clock, and he goes, "Oh, my God." And you're like, "Well, there's a Best Buy at John Hancock building. Go over there." So he leaves, and now at 2 o'clock, you and I are looking at each other. I'm like, "Well, what are we going to do, play drums and bass? Holiday
you
songs,
had the Oscar Peterson Christmas thing on your cell phone."
So I plugged it into
plugged it into the keyboard amp, and we just kind of pantomimed to it.
I
put his hat. Yeah, and guess what? Nobody knew anything.
No. People were coming by telling us we sounded great.
Yeah. Yeah, we got Oscar Peterson playing with Ray Brown and you and I are just sitting there. We're kind of just, you know, pantomiming to the music, you know.
So
and
then,
people go, "It's really great, man.
You guys sound dynamite." We're getting thumbs up. So a half hour later, Jim comes back with an adapter, and he forgot his jacket, by the way. So he's frozen.
Right.
He's ice frozen. He ran across down two blocks down. He's frozen. He comes back. His head's all red. He comes in, and none of the adapters work to plug his keyboard in.
That's so, when he went down and bought a piano.
He got in a cab and went to Piano Forte and bought a piano. And brought a piano. And now I look out, we got 5 minutes left in this one spot. And nobody knows. The client's super happy, man. We're swinging along. Everybody's cool. And I look out, and here comes this guy in a sport coat. The wind's going 40 miles an hour. He's got a cardboard box with a keyboard in it, and he's coming at the door, and I'm like waving him off. I go to the other room. Don't
go to the other one.
Get out of here. Nobody knows what's happening. Go away.
Oh man.
So then he's like, oh. So then he goes to the other room. I go in there, and he tells Nick and I he took a cab down to Piano Forte in the South Loop, bought a keyboard. Brought it back up, and then he played it and everything. I mean, he felt horrible. He was a sweetheart of a guy to be able to go do that. And and everybody loved it. And we've been called back, what, 3 different times now. We keep playing that gig now. It's called adapting. called an adapter and an adapting situation.
Yeah. So every piano player, including
Mjolnir.
Our friend Mjolnir. Yep. Who I taped his thing with electric tape a couple of times, should have at least 2 of those things, one in a case, one in a car, or 2 in a whatever.
Yep.
And those little, adapters, man, DC adapter,
Yeah, power cord, man. It's called a power cord. If you need power, you should have more than one power cord.
That's right.
If you're being paid to do something. It's a very important situation. So, all right, well... We could tell stories probably until 3 o'clock this afternoon, but we will have you back on to do some more of those because I have a feeling this is going to last a little while. But thanks for being on. Thanks for bringing our reporter on the Western Front. I like that. We can call in, check in with Nick.
Call out here and I'll let you know what's headed your way.
Hopefully some gigs soon, huh?
Yeah, man. We'll keep it going, man. Yeah. Whatever,
Man,
Well, I hope everybody's going to be safe. I guess stay in. I got a mask. I'm wearing it in and out when I go in and out. Now I'm wearing my mask and I'm running low on masks, so I'm gonna have to go find some place where they got masks. I went to Menards, and got one of those painter masks. Those are no good.
It's not going to do anything for you.
Yeah. So I got some of these cloth masks that left over from the hospital. So we'll use those and stay in. And you know what I think I'm going to do, Mike? I was going to write a children's book yesterday, maybe 5 pages or something, Stay in, shut up, be nice to your parents, little tips like that.
Picture you on
but
the cover.
I decided that I would write a cookbook now.
You know what? Here, check out how professional this show is. I'm gonna give you some applause.
Okay.
There you go. You hear that?
Yeah, there you go.
I've even got in honor of you, Nick. I've also got another instrument for you.
Okay, good, man.
And a party.
There you go.
There you go. I'm all ready, man. We're ready to rock and roll.
There you go.
All right. So when you do that children's book, you got to let us know. We'll have you back on the show.
It's the easiest thing to write, man. I got a bunch of photographs. I just throw in a thing and I type up some stuff and just throw it in and I'm done,
Mr. Nick's neighborhood. I can see it coming. I'll host it. Done.
Yeah. Why not, man? Anything to make a buck, man,
Hey. Times are tough. You got to do something.
I know, man.
All right. Hang loose.
Okay.
Have a good time out there, and I'll talk to you offline, I'm sure, in the near future.
Okay.
All right. Thanks, Nick.
Mike. All right. Be safe.
Bye.
Okay. Bye-bye.
All right. Nick Schneider, ladies and gentlemen. Let's thank him for being on the show today. How about that? How about that picture right there, huh? That's something to... to remember for sure. And, appreciate Nick being on. And of course, all the people that have been on this entire week, I think this show's going along pretty good. We're going to dial it in. So next week, we're going to start doing Chicago Music Revealed at 11:30 PM, unless my schedule might fluctuate a little bit next week, because as most of you know, I'm also the director of programming and entertainment at the Epiphany Center for the Arts. That's going to be opening up, was supposed to open up in April. So we're looking at probably, fingers crossed, end of May, middle of June, sometime that time. So we're going to do some special events there leading up to it. So I'll keep everybody posted. But we are doing some different things over there, social distance wise. But I've got to pop over there for a couple of different things, just to check in on a couple of musicians and other things that we're doing over there next week. And since there's nobody there, I can actually go in there by myself and check everything out on the situation and be safe the entire time we're doing that. So 11:30 a.m. Thanks, Dave Katzman. I just saw that. 11:30 a.m. Sorry, Tracy. Yes, 11:30 a.m. I'm glad you guys are paying attention because I'm not. 11:30 a.m. next week, next Monday, we will be back here with another episode. I'm going to actually start reaching out. We're going to have a lot of different genres of music on here next week, I have a feeling. And we're also going to be bringing in some Skype calls and some Skype people from, I think our correspondent from L.A. is going to be on next week as well. Craig Pilo, I believe, is going to make a special appearance. Our drummer friend from L.A. So that's always an experience. Every time he was on my radio show, he made it a habit of coming on, and we had a great time. And even when he was on tour, he toured with Frankie Valli for 15, 20 years. So, I mean, anytime he was coming through town, he would always pop over to the radio station or pop over to wherever I was doing this. And he was always nice enough to show up, and we always had some great banter, similar to what Nick and I just did. So stand by on that. Everybody stay safe over the weekend. Again, if you have events coming up, Facebook Live events or anything like that, be sure to put it in the comments, DM us, email us at info@chicagojazz.com. We might have a special correspondent doing that next week. So let's keep things going. We're staying together as a community during this tough time. Hopefully this show helps you out. Thanks to everyone that is commenting on. And the commander is checking in from Rockford. It's always a pleasure having the commander on from Rockford. Stay safe out there, commander, and stay safe, everyone out there. Everybody have a great weekend. And until Monday, hopefully I will see you somewhere on the scene soon. If not, I'll see you next Monday. Have a great weekend.